It is my absolute total pleasure to welcome Harmony Holiday here for a talk and discussion on voice and tone in Kamau, Brathwaite, and Abbey Lincoln. Harmony has worked in performance, dance, film, curatorial projects, archives. She's the author of 5 collections of poetry. She's steeped in music and is currently working on a biography and a collection of essays on Abbey Lincoln. She also curates archives in Los Angeles at MOCA and 2220 Arts, and she is, I believe, a great mind and spirit in our time. We're going to have a pretty open forum discussion. Harmony will be sharing some sound with us. We're going to do a listening session, listening and discussion, open forum. Feel free to participate and unmute yourself if you're if you'd like to kind of participate in the conversation actively, or feel free to use the chat, and we will direct the questions and conversation that way. And thank you all again for coming. I'm so deeply grateful to Harmony for joining us, and please join me in welcoming Harmony.
Hi, thank you everyone for coming. Thank you for the introduction and for inviting me. This is a fun format. I feel like I love collective improvisation as like a method of learning and study, and it's not common that you get invited to do something that involves that, where it can be more interactive. So just to preface, I'm working on a biography of Abbey Lincoln. It's more, I'm calling it the Abbey Lincoln album, and it's more using her archive, which is at the Rutgers Center Institute for Jazz Studies in Newark, and kind of talking back and forth with it, because she has a pretty extensive archive and she wrote pretty extensively. She wrote a lot of poetry on the page, as well as, and she would spontaneously kind of go into recitations of poetry during interviews, but that wasn't the extent of her practice. She also wrote a ton, journaled frequently, has really interesting documentation of even things like her time in the airport during tour. And so you can go through the years of her life and see, you know, like when she was feeling great in the airport and married to Max Roach and feeling kind of like celebrated. And then when she was feeling like a woman in her 70s who was alone and kind of like left to tour solo without that kind of care or attention. And through the whole time, what's kind of striking is she doesn't have like a complaint tone in her. Like, whereas you hear a lot of people talk about their careers and get bitter over those kind of things, she sort of plays with the changes in like a really interesting way. And also, being a student of Kamau, Brathwaite, there's a similar, I see a correlation there with like terrible things happening to them throughout their lives, like, but not ever resorting to a tone of pure complaint and always transmuting it into some other energy, into a project or into something like that. And Kamau also was a huge archivist. He had an archive that burned down in Barbados and just spent a lot of time like mourning that loss and also groping for ways to collect kind of like ephemeral memories or diasporic memory that was left. And they also share that. But in the academy, like comparative lit, I think it's lacking, especially for Black people, oral tradition. There isn't, for me, comparative lit is more tonal. And so rather than comparing just to literary writers, I think it's valuable to compare outside of genre, like to compare between genres. Like there are filmmakers who inflect, like certain writers and singers who inflect, like, you know, piano players and things like that. So I just thought it would be interesting as a group to do some like listening and comparing of how they channel similar things tonally. And I'll start, I'm gonna read from this book. Kamau also taught comparative literature. This is a book called Roots that he wrote. And he was a great theorist, which is surprising because his poetry is so surreal. It's not surprising, but it's kind of surprising that he could switch between registers as deftly as he did. And I'm just going to read a couple passages from this. So he says, "We are therefore faced with the strange situation where the work of a body of writers mainly concerned with the communal values of their Creole society is examined in a more or less academic fashion by a body of critics trained to respond almost exclusively to European influences and whose main concerns are with the artist and the individual." And then he goes on a bit later, talking about emancipation. The African culture focused upon a religious core, which survived and flourished under slavery, came under a very severe attack at emancipation. Under slavery, it had been possible for plantation slaves, not those immediately or always under the surveillance of the master, to continue practicing their religion, and therefore their culture, or at least those elements of it that had survived under the conditions, elements signaled by things like drum, voice, obeah, song, tale, and herb. With emancipation, however, all of this came under attack for a number of quarters. In the first place, the missionaries were naturally against the African-oriented religious practices among their ex-African adherents, hence the banning of the drum, voice of God or worship, Nyam, one of the three Akan names of the supreme being. The gradual replacement of African foods and food styles, Nyam, Yam, or by European or Creole substitutes, and the Christianization of names, Nomo, Bantu, for the word, and ideas, Nam. It was possible after emancipation to do this more and more effectively because there was no longer any legal restriction on missionary activity that had existed under slavery. Slowly, the ex-slaves began to lose or disown the most crucial elements of their culture in the very area where it was most important and venerable. They began, in other words, to go to churches and chapels rather than to beat the drums. Second, the process of education became first clerical, then secular, but always colonial. Depending on who owned the territory, the ex-slaves were to be molded into the British or French or Spanish system. They began to learn to read and write so that they were diverted from their oral tradition of their inheritance. They became literate in a language that was foreign to them, liberated into a culture which was not theirs. They began, in other words, to read about Versailles and Let Them Eat Cake and Lord Nelson and Robin Hood and other frescoes of irrelevant nursery rhymes, which some time ago the mighty sparrow decelebrated in the Calypso. I love that word, decelebrated, that he finds. At the same time, there was no countervailing influence to help them learn about their own tradition. This, of course, did not have to happen. It was conceivable that the education could have been truly bicultural, so that, who knows, we might have struggled through Ashanti Twi or the Zulu epics, as well as a French, Latin, and Anglo-Saxon. However, under the dictates of mercantilism, education had more monolithic and material aims, control of the ex-slaves for the profit of their labor. So I think it's interesting. I never really thought about ways that freedom was reined in after emancipation. And it's really interesting that he picks up on that. I'm just gonna share my audio and play some Kamau, and then I'll read a little bit and then play some Abbey Lincoln. Have people heard him read? Anyone? No? Okay. I don't want to be redundant.
Drink, may you rest, for the year has come round again. Kong, 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 kung, 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 funtumi akori, treniboa akori, treniboa kodia, kodia treniduru, odomankuma charimase, odomankuma charimase, oko babia, oko babia, wamani ho meniso. Wamani ho meni so, akoka bonapa, akoka to a bon, ahima hima hima, ahima hima hima, funtumi akori, treniboa akori, spirit of the cedar tree, treniboa kuya, odamankuma charimases, odamankuma charimases, the great drummer of odamankuma says, The great drummer of Odamankuma says that he has come from sleep, that he has come from sleep, and is arising like a cock of the cock, like a cock of the cock who clucks, who crows in the morning, who crows in the morning. We are addressing you, Yere Cheriwo. We are addressing you, Yere Cheriwo. Listen, let us succeed. Listen, may we succeed. Gong gongs throw pebbles in the routed pools of silence. News of ripples reach the awakened Zulus. Chaka tastes the salt blood of the bitter Congo. And all Africa is one, is whole. Nim tree shaded in Ghana, in Chad, Mali, the shores of the cooling kingdoms. Beat heaven of the drum. Beat the dark leaven of the dungeon ground where buds are wrapped, twisted runged dancing shoots. White salt crackles at root lips, bursts like a fist, and beats out this prayer. Nana Firimpong, once you were here, hoed the earth and left it for me, green, rich, ready with yam shoots, the tuberous smooth of cassava. Take the blood of the fowl, drink, take the ito, mashed plantain that my women have cooked. Eat and be happy. Drink, may you rest, for the year has come round again. Asasiya, you mother of earth.
Now I'm gonna play Abbey Lincoln, her speaking.
The man who has the magic just waves his wand and weaves a spell. The man who has the magic must know a secret he won't tell, because he's a high lord and a master. Ooh, mischievous scamp. Did he discover old man Aladdin's lamp? His eyes are like the sunrise. He's lightning fast and fancy free, and he knows some razzle dazzle. Got his mind on sorcery. He's a high lord and a master. Yeah, the man with the magic. The one who practices the arts. They're all over the planet.
Why are we doing so bad?
Because we do not worship God in our own image and likeness. You're not supposed to worship other people's images. It's the first commandment in the Bible. I don't know how they do this, but they do it. You know God's name, really, and it's not yours? How did you manage to do that? You don't know your name, but you know God's name.
So that's the root of all this confusion?
Of all of this, yes. Where are the African gods? Did they leave us on our journey over here? Where are the African gods? Will we know them when they suddenly appear? The ones dismissed with voodoo, rock and roll, and all that jazz. And jungle, mumbo jumbo, and razzmatazz. Where are the African gods who live within the skin? Within the skin, without the skin, and in the skin again. Do they hide among the shadows while we stumble on the way? Or did they go with heaven to prepare another day? Where are the African gods who'll save us from this misery and shame? Where are the African gods? Will we find them while we pray in Jesus' name? Where are the African gods who live and set us free? We are the African gods. We are. You and me.
Abbey Lincoln, Aminata Moseka, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
So you can kind of hear that was Abby like later in life, and she was a drinker, and so you can hear kind of between the screaming that she did in the 60s for albums that she recorded with Max Roach. I don't know if people are familiar, but the Freedom Now suite that was recorded in 1959, it's her and Max Roach, and there's a track on it where she just screams for a really long time, and that kind of like ripped up her vocal cords because she wasn't trained in screaming. And between that and drinking, you can hear her tone is very different at this point in her life. But I love that's an example of her just like slipping into memorized poetry during what was like a formal interview where she was just being asked questions that she could have answered very literally. And I think they share, you don't really hear it in Kamau in the part of the recording that I just played, but they're both like a very like subdued belligerence about them where it's like, yes, I'm belligerent. Yes, I'm like constantly seething, but they're able to channel it into a sort of like reverb instead of into just like pure rancor, which I think is unique because you can tell the difference. There's a slight difference that you can definitely perceive between that kind of register versus someone who I also love, like Amiri Baraka, who just like spits fire and is angry, or even my name is slipping, the woman who was married to Ornette Coleman. I'll think of it. But yeah, there are ways to recite, or even sometimes Nikki Giovanni's way of reciting where you sort of like move in downbeats and swoop downward to indicate like anger, basically, like a certain like cadence that you can attach to, that I think both of them sort of defy, but they achieve an effect that's really powerful. I'll read a little bit and then play some more, and then hopefully we can discuss what I play after that. Some of my notes. So Abbey Lincoln and Kamau Brathwaite are my extended family in the tradition of choosing or trusting affinity like you trust blood. They share a sense of belonging that is inherent in me, which tells them and us through them of misremembered or what Kamau calls decelebrated traditions that only the body harbors, traditions revoked by the conscious mind to protect it in lands where it was forbidden to be themselves. For them, the forbidden is the bidden or bidden forth, the calling, and what is denied must be pursued like treasure. They are both deliberate conjurers of those exiled memories and behaviors and patterns of thought and cadences who risk self-exile to remain as blunt as children. Abby sings with a frankness that is far less quivering than the timbre common to jazz women. She inflects without affect and doesn't insinuate fragility and recognize. She projects different conditions, exasperation, clarity, horror, realism, so sharp it flutters. Instead of trying to be fragile, she soars through being insatiable, infinitely curious, accessing the hue and tone of wonder and sometimes rejoice in her anger. Her ballads of sorrow dig and burrow beyond the crypt and make their way out, swinging, box, cheering, the next possibility, soul of the sparrow in the heart of a griot. Kamau also does not quiver like anger or whimper. He quivers like a whip reverberating after it lassos and strikes a former captor. Infects an unjust system with so much shame it buckles in agony. They unite in attaining a tone and range of tribute and total retribution. That retribution that is the ability to be true, to remain one even when assimilation into the clownish approximation of a self that is so lucrative in Western art calls them, especially Black artists. Audibly stubborn, they both turn blatant pain into a plaything. They defy the notion that suffering has to be terrible. they take it with ecstatic grace, and when translated to poetry, that when translated to poetry sounds like praise song, like mocking anyone who would try to disrupt them with steady evidence, invincible souls. I'm just gonna read, or I mean play, sorry. Some different versions of Porgy, which I think is a standard a lot of us might have heard. So there's like a Nina Simone version, a Billie Holiday version, and then Abbey Lincoln, just to hear kind of what I mean about her tone. Here's Billie.
Take me, don't let him handle me and drive me mad. If you can keep me, I want to stay here with you forever. And I'll be glad.
And then Nina Simone.
I love you, Porgy. Don't let him handle me and drive me mad. If you can keep me, I wanna stay with you forever, and I'll be glad. Yes, I love you, Porgy. Don't let him take me. Don't let him handle me with his hot hands. If you can keep me, I want to stay here with you forever. I've got my man.
Abbey's version. So that's sort of, it's pretty clear. I mean, she chooses a whole different segment of the history of that song, and she sings it with a whole different type of lift and lilt in her. I mean, she's almost like skipping along where the traditional porgy is really a lament, kind of always downcast. And you hear this brightness in her tone that I find really interesting and unique. I wanted to kind of open it up to talk. I mean, I have a lot more stuff to play and say, but I don't know. Did people hear a distinct difference between those two versions that sort of clarifies what I was reading about Abby's tone? You can also chat if people don't feel like speaking, or is her version surprising to anyone?
I really like how you describe her voice as bright.
Mm-hmm.
That really helped me to listen more closely, because it's really hard to put your words on, to put words to that quality of the voice, but definitely that's the big contrast, is that it's a bright, it's like a higher, whereas Nina and Billie Holiday, they're down in some dark, murky place with it.
Yeah.
And it's all blues, but it's interesting to hear how the blues can kind of permute into a brighter hue. In a way, it's almost like she's channeling, the blues more than them to me, because there are some, somewhere in the more traditional pre-jazz blues sound, there was that sort of like cheerfulness of music that was just like played at a party for the people around you, or like music that was played like while you were working or walking, that more formalized like concert jazz, when the music is concertized, which Nina and Billie are both very concertized in their own ways, it becomes, you kind of have to also perform the personality that's anticipated in a jazz standard. And that personality is very driven by consumers of it, instead of like the people who are around the music regularly. So I write about this in the book, but like rehearsal sounds very different than performance because of that. And Abby manages to sort of retain that rehearsal. Like it feels very much for herself, which I love. And you would think, or I went in thinking, that someone like Billie Holiday would be better at that, but I think she was a performer in a lot of ways, to almost to protect her spirit, and because of all the things she went through, and because sometimes she was in a very mercenary role, like in legal trouble or addicted to things, and she was just under different restrictions than Abby, who had a different set of issues. Let me see. I have more Kamau to play, but there's a really interesting version of Abby covering Stevie Wonder that I want to try to play, because it definitely is fun to compare their tones. All right, I'll do this really quick. The song Love Having You Around.
Cause I say it cause I love having you around. And I say it cause I love having you around. And I say it cause I love having you around. And I say I love having you around. Every day I wanna find my kind. Every day I wanna find day I wanna fly my kite. Every day I wanna get on my camel and ride. Every day I'm gonna be your friend, 'cause you've been here with me through thick and thin. Every day I wanna get on my camel and ride. And when the day is through, nothing to do, just sit around my love cooling with you. And I say it 'cause I love having you around. And I say it 'cause I love having you around. And I say it 'cause I love having you around. And I say it 'cause I love having you around. Every day I wanna give my share, you're gonna take me there. Every day I wanna get on my camel and ride.
Please. Mama, 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 baby. Baby, baby, baby.
You can see even there, there's something, she's more subtle, similar effect, but for some reason she's channeling from somewhere else. And there's almost like what I noticed shared between her and Kamau to bring him back in is like this feeling that they were exiled from whatever you're hearing in the other tones and then found something in a new place. Like they almost like myth making and this building of a space that's singularly both theirs. I'm just gonna play something more downcast by Abbey, just for range, to give a vibe.
So unhappy, left all alone. And she was as tender as a rose. She was as soft as snowy down, and from her head down to her toes, she was a dream that hung around. She was as fresh as April, warm as May. And all the fellas threw their hearts her way, but all of her loving was Joe's. She was as tender as a rose. I guess that Joe was pretty sick. His feelings went from cold to hot. Her love to him was just a kick. His ego needed her a lot. And when he took her away, she wore a smile. Fate crossed its fingers for that
lovely child, 'cause all of her loving was Joe's. She was as tender as a rose. She came back walking all alone. She wasn't gone for very long. She came back with a heart of stone. We knew that everything gone wrong. And when you ask her why she's out each night, she'll say, brother, once I tried to be right, once all of my loving was Joe's, I was as tender as a rose. She was as tender as a rose.
So you can hear how that like richness of tone with no instrumentation and nothing behind it, she can channel a story and it feels like there's accompaniment, like it somehow she's also doing that ancestral work that Kamau talks about, where she's bringing in things that can't be seen, but there's a vivid feeling that like there's something else, there's a presence there. And then I'm just gonna play a little bit more Kamau a cappella.
Tools on whose soil I will hoe, I will work. The year has come round again. Thirsty mouth of the dust is ready for water, for seed. Drink and be happy. Eat, may you rest, for the year has come round again. And may the year, this year of all years, be fruitful beyond the fruit of your labor. Shoots faithful to tip, juice to stem, leaves to green. And may the knife or the cutlass not cut me. Roots blunt, shoots break, green wither, wind shatter, damp rot, hot harmattan come drifting in harm to the crops. The tunneling termites not raise their red monuments, graves above the blades of our labor. Summon now the kings of the forest, horn of the elephant, mournful call of the elephant. Summon the emirs, kings of the desert, horses caparisoned, beaten gold bent, archers and criers, porcupine arrows, bows bent. Recount now the gains and the losses, Agadis, Sokoto, El Hassan dead in his tent, the silks and the brasses, the slow, weary tent of our journeys down slopes, dry river courses, land of the lion, land of the leopard, elephant country.
Do some like DJing back and forth just to get real comparison.
Yeah!
blood at its edges? Is it not Nadarina of which the sages speak? Perhaps, perhaps, the weak mind only seeks towards these things in dreams, in cracking sunlight's visions. But I heard the sound of silver running with the clink of water, as if a river were flowing soft and always south from here. For miles the land was brown and dry, for miles clear sky and rock. 3 days we traveled, dreaming, heavy tongues dumb, soles and our ankles numb, foreheads shocked with heat. The land was empty, and the rainless arch of nothing stretching stretched straight on. 3 days we traveled, insteps knotted, cords of our thighs flesh frayed and muscles afraid of the next hot step, the next hot slipping stone. 3 days we traveled to that low sky morning when we saw the mist, gray sticking breath, nosing the blind earth.
Lordy, Lord of love, God Almighty, God above, please look down and see my people.
Lips, labials rot, withering words in the hot wind. If you must speak, wear a black mask of silence, asking no elder to lead you again through the leaves, through the pathways of prayer, to Anyami's now leafless air. For I am the life of my people. Like the cock, I produce shocks of life. Like the hen, I bear eggs when the cycle is ripe. White salt, tasteless soul body, red yolk where the meaty heart beats. And when the cycle is ripe, I, giver of life to my people, crack open the skull, skill of shell, carefully carved craft of bones, and I kill. So for my hacked heart, veins, memories.
Went to old Malaya, what a perfect locale. And slipping and sliding and moving and coming and going.
back side by side, you can kind of hear where it's coming from, or, you know, where, what I might be hearing when I try to put them in a sort of caress together. And one thing I didn't mention before is just range, I guess. When I think of artists who really stun me for a long period of time, who I don't get bored with returning to again and again, it definitely has something to do with tonal range. And the ability to not just like get into one register and stay there your whole life. You know, the idea that even in the same song or the same poem, you, especially with Abby, she can go from like I said, belligerence to that sharp, just cutting through everything, and then back to this bright childlike, even in, you know, cataloging her wounds or her pain, she's like, sounds like she's almost celebrant of them. And Kamau, similarly, I feel like he retains like this like spectral sense in his voice. This, it never seems like he's given up in a certain way. If you hear him read, I mean, we haven't played his whole archive, but you hear him read early and then later in life, and he still is like drumming with his reading and like kind of pounding at the same. He has this one line about like throwing a pebble and create that ripple being like the sensibility in Caribbean diasporic poetics, this idea of like falsetto that I think comes through in both, but falsetto not in the traditional sense where it's just like one word being kind of like undulated, but in the sense where you can like pick up a theme and kind of jolt it and then pick it back up somewhere else. So kind of displaced falsetto, like where you start thinking about something, you let yourself be interrupted by a completely different emotion and then pick up the root topic again. And to me, they're both really great at that kind of juggling, that emotional juggling, where you'll hear Abby in the same song, that song I played of her screaming, and you know, that screaming is insane and it's really jarring, but then 2 minutes later, she's got this like lilting, you know, lullaby-ish sway in her voice. And it just allows you to move with them pretty organically, I think, when those flips happen, almost like they do in the personality throughout a day, instead of feeling contrived. I guess there's an element that I hear both of them of lack of contrived, which is important to me, and just stuff that I like to listen to, I guess. Yes, exactly. They're both master storytellers, I think. But yeah, did anyone else see a question? Is there anything of use to be said, thought about the way A and B come from overlapping and different traditions? Sorry, do you mind clarifying that question? I'm not sure. Do you mean like the blues A and B?
Yeah, and in terms of place, geographical.
Oh, yeah. Yes, well, Abby, yeah, I didn't really give biographical information. Kamau Brathwaite is from Barbados, did spend a lot of time in the US teaching in New York. And then Abby is from the South. She was like between Chicago and between Chicago and the Midwest, Michigan, but grew up kind of on a farm in an isolated environment. So their environments don't really overlap a ton, although they both ended up in New York at different periods. Obviously, lineage is more overlapping. They're both descendants of slaves and share that. But I feel like they both channel a sensibility that's kind of beyond place in a certain sense, even though Kamau does write a lot about the Caribbean aesthetic specifically. What he writes about the Caribbean for some reason resonates with me in terms of thinking about my own family's heritage in like Mississippi or New Orleans, because there is that like tropical element of the United States that I think gets overlooked. And sometimes I feel like the Caribbean theory makes a lot more sense to me than like purely theory of like a Southern US aesthetic, because it's like, there's a lot of essentialism, I guess, in like theorizing American Blackness in terms of like, there was a South, like spirituals are very fetishized. And so you get this like, everything comes from the church essentialism. And what I like about the Caribbean side of things is that it's not as much, that's not, Kamau kind of channels and everything comes from the drum idea. And so I guess in that sense, that does bring me to think like they're both a little bit more like secular in their approach to sound, even though they understand the rooted, and both a little bit more, I guess, drum based. Like Abby, it's no accident that she married one of the best bebop drummers, Max Roach. And that she, I think she understood the importance of the drum versus maybe other people who their primary focus is like the scripture or the cadence of scripture. Like if you look at someone like James Baldwin, he writes like some, like a preacher, you know? And they aren't preachy. So I think, yeah, that's a great question because it makes me realize that. And preachiness can get boring, you know? It can sound like a typical protest. So yeah, that's something I guess I was trying to figure out, this is really helpful with, is like, what makes protest music, or I mean, even that's an essentializing, you know, category, but it can be interesting when things that are very in protest don't take on the expected registers. And so you don't necessarily have to go in noticing, you know, it's not always against, but just like what is being conjured alone stands in protest. Nina Simone talks about protest songs ruining her career. I mean, she's one of the greatest artists of ever, but her protest songs are very saliently like angry and protest songs. And with Abby, it's like, she could be screaming for any number of reasons. It's obviously a protest song, but if 50 years from now, someone hears that song Triptych that I played that has her screaming and then, you know, moaning and then humming, you might not know, you know, depending on how disjointed things become, what tradition she's screaming about. Whereas with Mississippi Goddamn or something, like you're always gonna know that that's about what it's about. Yeah, thanks for that question.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks so much for putting all these materials together and talking with us. I think it was about a year and a half ago or 2 years ago now, almost, I got to hear you and Fred in one of those early pandemic stage Zoom listening sessions. And it struck me how important it was that both of you wound up, I'm not even sure you planned it, talking about silence and hearing silence, but also whole ranges of what silence can be. And what you were playing today, both with Brathwaite and with Abby, reminded me of how much they think about what it means to know where a beat is and to be just ahead of it or behind it, and how that's part of silence. And everyone who works in poetry and music, it's one of the first things we learn, that you need to know the beat, and then you know how to need to know how to not be only determined by it.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering how in both of their materials that you're working with, you see those themes, but also the forms of silence as not just the absence of sound or movement. The stuff you brought in today was so suggestive of all of that. Anyway, thank you. And any thoughts you have about that, I'd be grateful for.
Yeah, thanks for reminding me of that silence meditation that Fred and I stumbled into. I'm writing a book for Duke now that's kind of on silence. So I definitely am thinking a lot about it, and they probably drawn to them because of that on some level. But I think what I hear shared in them as far as like a relationship to quiet and silence is kind of playing with the concept that is getting more and more popular now, like of horror. Like the silence I hear is like horrified kind of in both of them, or this sort of suspenseful pacing that can do that thing I was saying, like can protest without blatantly declaring what it's against necessarily, because there's space for the horrific, or there's like this gaping void in pauses. Like when you hear Kamau reading without anything behind him, you can kind of hear like when he pauses, he's like, he talks a lot about like the trickster god and like the voodoo tradition, and that often the myth of Legba is that he would like stumble in limping, but then he would like dance and fuck you up, and like he could beat you up. He was like a superhero who would like come in like, you know, like he couldn't do anything, and then all of a sudden be showing out. And they kind of both have that sort of like trickster element with their silence. Like you, even me, like as much as I've spent listening to Abby, I always hear something new where I'm always worried because I know too much of her story, maybe like about late in life and her getting into drinking and things like that. So I know that she was sort of like ruining herself on some level, but even through that, she was also elevating. So it's a really weird contrast to hear her later in life recording, because she gets better at doing all these things we're talking about, but her voice, you know, in traditional senses kind of deteriorates, just in terms of like the actual chords of it. But yeah, she tricks you into thinking, or at least me, like she is gonna mess up kind of, but then the song gets better. Like even in the last song I just played, I don't know, it's a long song. It's like, how long is it? Maybe 8 minutes long. And there aren't enough verses to really span the 8 minutes, but what she does at the end, like it, she prevents it from getting boring by the way she improvises. But when I first listened, I'm like, all right, this might get boring. Like you could easily turn off the song thinking like it's gonna be redundant, but then she finds a way of jumping somewhere completely different. And she definitely uses suspense and silence to do that. So I think maybe that's what I'm hearing in them both. Which goes back to that playfulness. Like you can't really accomplish that unless you're kind of like playing with your audience and yourself a little bit, like having a bit more fun.
Let's take maybe one more question if anyone has, or final thoughts, or if you've prepared a final thing for us to listen to.
The body as an instrument for making music. Definitely that. Especially Abby. Oh, go ahead.
You had talked in the beginning a lot about the loss that they've both encountered. I had no idea his archives burned down, which is unbelievable. Wow.
Yeah.
But it really does seem like, I guess, I wonder if you have anything more to say about loss and how they channel the loss. As you were saying, it's not like, you know, they don't kind of go towards a pure complaint mode, but it does seem like there is underlying both of their work that loss coming through, but almost as a, like, it gets channeled into something kind of higher or deeper or, you know, but I wonder if you have anything more to say about that.
Yeah, I mean, since Abby, Kamau's archives burned down, and Abby's in her personal life, I mean, her relationship with Max Roach was really volatile. He was a bit violent, and in a sense, her own archives burned down too, because she had this legacy of doing all this work with him, and she just lost that. So I think you can hear a clear difference from like her bebop era recordings to when she was forming new bands and trying to piece back a career. She changed her name. She went to South Africa with Miriam Makeba and was given like a naming ceremony, and she became Amanita Moseka. And Kamau talks a lot about renaming as like a kind of rebirthing process. I think their approach to loss is more about renewal, I guess. like it seems like they both have that trauma response where some people kind of sink into despair and they just seem like people who share an ability to not despair as the first reflex in a terrible situation. And so with that, it's like it makes them better practitioners of what they're doing.
And you have you been able to be in contact with their daughter, Maxine?
No. My literary agent has been, because he helped get Max Roach's archives to, I think they're at UPenn or something. But no, I hear she's pretty dope. Do you know her?
I don't. I just thought that it was so amazing after the breakup that she's, of course, such a fabulous musician on the viola.
Yeah.
And they did that last album where they had her playing with the band. And so I was just fascinated about whether you might have some conversation with her and the amazing light she might have to shed from both sides.
Yeah, I think she was not Abby's biological daughter and just Max, like Max's from his first marriage. So I didn't know, did she record with Abby and Max together?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. I need to definitely interview her. I'm just going this summer to dig into the archives. I'm going to find her. Do you know how old she is?
I'm guessing by now she might even be in her 40s.
Okay.
Those She's albums not, like, were from like the 1990s.
Okay. Oh my God, I have to find her.
Yeah.
Yeah. Word. Thank you.
That sounds exciting. Good luck with it.
Thanks. Yeah. It's like a new approach to. There's so much talk about trauma narratives these days and like how they, you know, there was that whole article that came out about someone being like bored with the trauma plot or whatever, which I think is whatever. Who cares? But one person, there's a lot you could say about that. But I think that in comparing these two voices, you can kind of hear that they themselves might bored with trauma being projected onto them. And like, how do you channel a poetics that does not solely privilege shit that's happened to you that's fucked up, basically, for lack of a better, you know, like, how do you talk about those things without sacrificing your whole identity and the variousness of yourself and all those layers? Because I think so much of what's expected of Black music and poetry, especially kind of now, is tell us about how you suffered and we will reward you accordingly to the, you know, in direct relation to how much you have suffered. And even with narratives of like reparations and repair and restitution, there's this pushing us toward like a catalog of disaster. And so I love people who are able to like push that in a different direction somehow. Should I play some last Abbey tune, Revives?
Sure.
I could listen to her all day because of that range, but maybe I'll play some like an outro Abbey. Let me see. Here's a song. So she wrote lyrics to a monk song and she didn't tell him. She just like wrote them, like wrote a poem and started singing it. And he approached her at some point and was like, you could have just told me. Like you didn't need to, he was like, she has an interview where she talks about how he gave her confidence in songwriting because she was like secretly writing songs. I think it did affect her like emotionally and maybe her self-esteem, whatever happened with Max, because so much of her was in the shadow. And a lot of times when I mention I'm writing about her or thinking about her, people only nod when I say Max Roach's wife, you know? So I think she just wasn't as confident as she was great at certain points, but here's a song she wrote for Monk. Share this again.
Thank you.
Life is a school, lest you're a fool, but the learning brings you pain. Knowing at once you're just a dunce, trial and error, loss and gain. It takes some doing, monkery's a slow.
Even there, like you mentioned, there's that lagging behind, like she plays with where she is on the beat, and it's really effective. But yeah, there's more to say, but hopefully that gets people like deep diving into their voices.
Yeah, thank you so deeply, Harmony.
Thank you all. Yeah, it was really fun. Yeah, I'm now gonna like listen to Abbey all day, but I was probably gonna do that anyways.
I'm really amazed by the range that you presented in such a compact period of time. It's like astounding. Thank you so much.
It was really fun. Thanks for listening and for asking really great questions and mentioning Maxine. Now I have like real things to do, get handled. Appreciate
Thanks
it.
Thanks so much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank everyone for coming.
Thanks, Harmony.
Enjoy your Sunday.